Okay, here we are on another away mission. I think this is planet Belize, and we're about to go on some sort of cave tubing expedition.
Obvious to me is that your father should have left you to rot in that Breen prison camp. But he didn't. He took pity on you. And it's your duty to repay him. Now come with me.
Let her go.
And if I don't, what happens then?
I was hoping you'd ask.
The arc of that character was so extraordinary. And so surprising, not only to me, but to the writers themselves. The last day of shooting, the guy that created this character, Hans Beimler, he said to me, he said, you know, we had no idea where we were going to take this character. And it surprised us where we took it.
You heard her. She was a traitor.
When I read in the script that I was going to die, right? The last 10 minutes of the last episode of the last, to the seventh year. I said, okay, fine. I'm dying a hero. That's good. But I'm looking at, I get killed by a nondescript alien, it said. By the Jem Hadar. They always remind me of big rhinoceroses. That guy. I said to the director, I said, oh, I can't be killed by a nondescript alien. So he let me do what I wanted, which was have this big bullet ballet, which is what I wanted, to go out with a blaze of glory with the last word. So that was good.
He's dead.
Remember his orders. We stop for nothing.
The first one was Chorus. Then there was the first Cardassian I did in Deep Space Nine. The next one was, I believe, the Romulan Telek Remor.
I am a low-ranking scientist, a minor functionary.
A Vidian, a Hirogen, two of nine, I'm Seven's older brother, Korath. I was the last Klingon in Voyager. Oh, I did another a Cardassian in Deep Space Nine, Glenn Seskal.
Shields are down.
I've got the sample, Commander, and it's stable. Let's get out of here.
I got the impression that when there were issue shows, that they would use Neelix. For the issues, I mean, there was Jatrell and Mortal Coil.
Mortal Coil,
where,
yeah.
Where you died and had to deal with that.
Yeah, wonderful show.
He's dead.
They like to take a non-human when they deal with issues like that, to distance the audience from a human involvement, so that it can almost like it's in bas relief, so they can look at it from a different perspective and examine the issue. An alien somehow can grapple with it in a different way. The Mortal Coil was a great show because it was very existential. I mean, what would you do if you learned for certain that there was no God?
Nothing. What?
I died, and there was nothing.
That was a great thing about Star Trek. There were always, most of the time, great stakes to play. And everything was very heightened. And that's why so many actors in Los Angeles love to be on the show.
I don't feel like Neelix anymore. Maybe Neelix is gone. Maybe he died, and I'm all that's left.
Stop moving and allow me to complete the scan.
I didn't ask to be brought back!
You were dead at the time.
Well, what right did you have to violate me?
What are you doing?
Activating intruder alert.
That's the last thing you want to do.
Security!
Listen to me. This vessel has been taken over by Romulans. The crew is dead. You and I are the only Starfleet officers on board. Do you understand?
I was delighted with the long, wonderful arc that the writers had created for the Doctor. I mean, arguably, he traveled more, he developed more than any other character, simply because he started further back, so he had longer to go. And the other great thing about playing the Doctor is that he didn't go to Starfleet Academy, so he doesn't have to obey all those rules of, you know, of how a Starfleet officer should behave. He doesn't have to be stalwart, brave, and true. He could be complaining and cowardly and, you know, self-important.
This is all very complicated.
Stop breathing down my neck.
My breathing is merely a simulation.
So is my neck. Stop it anyway.
Is this a thruster control?
Don't touch that. We don't know what it does. It could be the self-destruct.
I love that part, that I could break the rules.
I got a Cardassian neck. What the heck? Wearing Klingon shoes. They give me the blues. I love the Hirogen hunt. My board can't be blunt. I got Vidian flesh. I'm such a mesh. I got the blues.
I did a scene with Armin in Quark's bar. And the writers just happened to like the way I looked sitting in that bar. I think I pulled Armin over the bar and threw him down or something. And then from then on, I was an alcoholic. But oh, that was horrible stuff. Oh my God, that they made me drink.
The canard.
It was Karo syrup. Because the producer said, oh, it should be thick. So, you know, the prop people go out and they say, oh, thick, thick, thick. What do we do to thick? Oh, Karo syrup. They put some coloring in it. And I'm doing the shot, you know, and I take a drink of it. Oh, God, it was just terrible. And I had to look like it tasted good, so hell of an actor.
It was a three-hour process to take it, to put it on, and about an hour and a half to remove it. And then usually another hour or hour and a half during the day, depending on the heat, to maintain it. Because, you know, it's for HDTV, so it has to be seamless. You couldn't screw with it. You couldn't lean back because the hair would be crushed. You couldn't talk on a phone because the phone would stick to it.
Stay still.
You couldn't read because of the contact lenses. It was sensory deprivation. The only thing you could do was talk and hang around the craft service table. So by season 7, I weighed 409 pounds.
Ooh, a little breakfast.
I had a wristwatch on each arm. They were in different time zones. I was putting mayonnaise on aspirin. I remember seasoning my food with food.
We're relying on an alien technology to send you across thousands of light years.
So there's a chance my program could be lost.
Yes, I'm asking you to take that chance.
35 seconds.
Doctor?
Far be it for me to turn down an opportunity to become a hero. I'm ready.
How does a flesh and blood human being, an actor, prepare themselves to play a computer program?
Well, the great thing is, if the character has no backstory, you don't have to research it. I think it puts more... I think it really taxes your imagination maybe a little more because you can't do the standard course of study.
Computer, initiate emergency medical holographic program.
Please state the nature of the medical emergency. When you play a computer program that's just been activated for the first time and you have no backstory, you have to look at what the design of the program was, what he was intended to be, and how he succeeds, but how he doesn't succeed, how the technology doesn't quite work, and what the comic potential, and even the dramatic potential for the character not quite working.
If there's anything you need or want, I'd like to see that you get it.
What I'd like is to be turned off when people leave. I spend hours here with absolutely nothing to do.
Riario.
Had 2 days to memorize paragraphs of Klingon dialogue. And I don't know if you know Klingon, but yes, there are millions of people out there that know exactly what it means. And to me, it's gibberish. You know, you try to memorize that, which you have to get verbatim, because otherwise they're going to call you on it. They may take a break, which, if you ask me, might be a wise thing to do because they have inundated us with Star Trek now for some 17 years, as you say.
The last two-part episode couldn't satisfy every character fully. So it was concentrated on Janeway's character, and Kate was terrific in the last show, and the rest of us had little less to do.